SBS acknowledges the traditional custodians of country and their connections and continuous care for the skies, lands and waterways across Australia.
You're listening to Australia Explained, an SBS audio podcast helping you navigate life in Australia.
Yira Damarang, hello, I'm Luana Grant, executive producer of NITV Radio, and I'll be your host for this special episode of Australia Explained. Each place in Australia carries distinct history spanning tens of thousands of years of country, culture and language. A growing shift in built environment design aims to make this local knowledge visible in our living spaces. In this episode of Australia Explained, both Indigenous and non-Indigenous experts share insights on creating spaces and buildings that draw from both Aboriginal and Western knowledge systems. A core expression of Australian Indigenous heritage and continuous practice is embedded in country itself, extending to the living spaces we inhabit, including urban environments. So, how should architects, government bodies, and creative practitioners interact with Indigenous knowledge when designing our surroundings? Professor Brian Martin is a descendant of Bundjalung, Murawari, and Kamilaroi peoples, originally from New South Wales. He is one of the co-authors of the International Indigenous Design Charter, setting best practice protocols for culturally responsive commercial design. In the built environment as elsewhere, designing with cultural considerations means community-specific design. Whether it is a public building, a square or a mural, design intersects with Indigenous culture at the very place the project is situated. Professor Martin explains how this approach reflects the diversity of Indigenous cultures in Australia.
We think about Indigenous knowledge, Indigenous ways of knowing, or when we think about design in particular, all knowledge comes from place, and that's why best practice protocols are about looking at locality and therefore traditional owners of that location and what knowledge and design and that sort of thinking that relates to that particular place and country. So, you know, Indigenous-led is country-led.
Architect Jeffa Grenaway agrees. He is one of the early recognised Aboriginal architects in Victoria, originally from New South Wales, a descendant of the Wallawan, Kamilaroi and Dharawal peoples. Mr Grenaway explains that acknowledging the diversity of Indigenous cultures in architecture goes beyond mere inclusion. It promotes design equity.
Invariably, First Nations people haven't necessarily had a seat at the table to engage within major built form projects. And so it really becomes an opportunity to support voice and agency.
And reasserting the primacy of country means designing projects which tell the history of a place in all its dimensions, not just geography, but also links to kinship and songlines.
What I mean by that is understanding where a project is located and the specific country or language group in which it's situated. We know across this vast island continent that there are over 270 distinct language groups and 600 dialects.
Walking around Melbourne University's city campus, you can see an example of this country-led design approach at the site where the student precinct connects with Swanston Street in the Central Business District. Mr. Grenaway, who co-led the project, shares insights into how the design process evolved.
Engage with a series of Indigenous stakeholders, traditional owners, elders, knowledge keepers, Indigenous students, Indigenous staff, the university, and we sought to capture their voices. What came out very clearly through the engagement was that there was a story around an eel migration in proximity to the site. And so what we sought to do through the design proposition was to daylight the old watercourses.
The team designed an amphitheatre and plaza route to recreate the creek, where eels have migrated through for more than 60,000 years on the traditional lands of the Kulin Nation to reach the Birrarung, the Yarra River, for breeding. They used native vegetation and materials and created a water collection network with ponds around the campus. The old creek line was also piped to support the city's stormwater system, and eels continued to migrate through it. Mr. Grenaway says this is an example of country-led design making cultural continuity visible.
It supports the idea of cultural continuity. So too often in the past, Indigenous culture has been framed around it is set back in time. What this does is it reframes and recasts an understanding that we're building upon a legacy of 67,000 years of continuous connection to this place.
Professor Martin says relationality is another key element of Indigenous-led design process. This means that it's important to engage deeply with the place and its people. Cultural protocols are not just checklist tasks that you can tick off without building a relationship first. Designers need to continuously engage with the place and its people, not view cultural protocols as checklist tasks ending at a certain project phase.
Relationality is a foundational part of our interactions with place and the agency of country. One of the specific principles of deep listening is really important. You know, that goes beyond the construct of time. Relationships are built around the time of the project, whether it be a research project or a design project, be an architectural firm or government body or practitioners themselves, still need to build the relationality with people and place.
Desiree Hernandez Ibn Arriaga is a Mexican woman of Mayan, Aztec and Basque heritage and senior lecturer at Monash University's Department of Design. During her PhD research, collaborating with Indigenous young women in Australia and Mexico and non-Indigenous teachers, she developed a project design methodology for privileging First Nations knowledge and biocultural diversity.
Something important in Indigenous methodologies is the sense of cultural identity because it's attached to how we see reality or our cosmology.
It is for this reason, Dr. Ibn Arriaga says, that relationship building is not just a prerequisite of country-led design, but an actual output. Before beginning her research with Indigenous teens, which culminated in a biocultural workshop, she spent several months as a resident at their boarding school in country Victoria. The workshop was designed aimed at strengthening students' cultural identity through links with country.
Indigenous methodology is something that we need to center is country, like the land, the skies, the waters that we live in. Basically, country, that is the place we exist in, I call it Tonantzintlali, that is Mother Earth in my ancestors' language in Nahuatl, but also relationality, that is the relationships that we have with the material and immaterial and all the entities as well.
Olivia Hyde is Director of Design Excellence at Government Architect New South Wales. Together with a team that includes Principal Architect Dylan Combum-Merry, a Yugambeh man from the Gold Coast in Queensland, they co-developed Connecting with Country Framework. Project stakeholders adapting the framework commit to design-build environment projects that deliver positive outcomes both for country and community. This includes reducing impacts of natural events through sustainable uses of land and water. 5 years in the making, the framework incorporates elements of country-led approaches, drawing inspiration from existing projects such as Parramatta Square, Ms. Hyde explains.
Parramatta Square is a great example of project teams already doing what the framework talks about. In a sense, they've led the framework. Most importantly, I guess, in regards to that, it was designed with Darug cultural knowledge holders right from the outset. So there was a very embedded process working with community in the development of the plans for the square.
Professor Martin says the opposite tokenistic approach to project design is not uncommon.
Background is mainly in the visual arts creative practice. So I've got the experience of being approached near the end of tendered processes where it's like, oh, we've got to include an Indigenous person. What gets missing in that narrative is it's not Indigenous led. You know, you end up with something that does not integrate the fabric of country within the process and then within the finished building product, whatever it may be.
Ms. Hyde says in the case of Parramatta Square, designers worked to make the history and continuing practices of the site visible. Features include an Indigenous artwork, a Darug gathering circle, and a series of inlays into the paving referencing historical evidence of Indigenous gatherings dating back thousands of years.
And it all comes together. You're sort of talking about something that talks to the long-term inhabitation, cultural importance of this place for Aboriginal people, but it's also about recognising that culture goes on and it's living and it's forever. And so it's making sure that living cultural practices can be kept alive and celebrated and are open to everyone, but also specific people where that's appropriate.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Australia Explained, written by Zoe Tomidu. Australia Explained Managing Editor is Rosa Germian, and I'm Luana Grant. Until next time.
This was an SBS audio podcast. For more Australia Explained stories, visit sbs.com.au/Australia Explained.